Good morning, all. Kindly respond. Okay, 160. Right, thank you. We might start with biological biomolecules. Okay, so we were there in 160th question, is it? Okay. So 20 more questions. Yeah, I think we saw this question. Which of the following is false about gonioliax? The reason for red tides because they are the reason for red tides because they release a red toxin is a wrong statement. The red color is not because of the toxin, but it is because of the color of the pigment present in them. So this third point is correct, not the first point. Okay, moving on further. What is plasmogamy is what they are asking. Plasmogamy is fusion of two nucleus. Okay. Usually it is fusion of two haploid cells. It is fusion of two haploid cells without nuclear fusion. So whenever you are talking about plasmogamy, the cytoplasm alone will be like kind of what? It will be fusing, but not the nucleus. The fusion of nucleus, we call it as karyogamy. After plasmogamy, there is a phase. What is that phase called as? After plasmogamy, there is a phase. What is it called as? Good. One person has said correctly. Giri Prakash, rephrase your answer, please. After plasmogamy and before karyogamy, there is a phase. That phase is called as dash phase. Chatvika, correct. Balamurgan tappu. Interkinesis enga vandu namba padichom. Where did we study about interkinesis? We studied about interkinesis in meiosis. Idu vandu idu enadhu? What are we talking about? Yeah, Ashwathi is correct. So please understand that plasmogamy, my God. Just a second. Children, wait, please. I have some difficulty. Yeah, just a second. Right. So you have plasmogamy. After plasmogamy and before your karyogamy, in between there is a phase. What is that phase? Is the question. Tanish wrong. So you have something called as a dikaryon. What is the meaning of dikaryon phase? Dikaryon means what? Two nucleus per cell. Okay, so this is what is the case. So here you are able to understand that there are two nucleus in between. So that is the case. Yeah, dikaryon means two nucleus, so it has to be N plus N. So here the question is, plasmogamy is fusion of what? Two haploid cells without nuclear fusion. After plasmogamy, you have that thing, nuclear fusion. Okay, Dash is an example for heterotrophic bacteria, they are asking. Okay, the moment you see this, this is green sulfur bacteria. This green sulfur bacteria is going to be photosynthetic, so which is autotrophic. Pseudomonas and lactobacillus are heterotrophic. Lactobacillus is something which will be responsible for bringing up curd. Pseudomonas is found in the soil. Okay, so it is like kind of a soil which will be it will live in soil, and then it will depend on organic substances. Okay, Pseudomonas is a very good example for environmental cleaner. Pseudomonas is a very good environmental cleaner. So it is a good decomposer. Okay. A virus can infect which of these followings? Please understand, virus cannot infect viroids, prions or other viruses. It can only infect bacteria. You have bacteriophages which can infect bacteria. Okay, cyanobacteria are what they are asking. Cyanobacteria can live in terrestrial also, as well as aquatic also. They can be both marine as well as freshwater. All the others are options are trying to tell whether it is trying to tell aquatic, but you please understand that cyanobacteria can live in damp soil regions also. So anywhere there is like kind of damp soil, you can see cyanobacteria. Okay, so now next one. Which of the following is the way in which a virus will multiply? Here, this is the option that A option is trying to show you. Lytic cycle. Okay, so A is describing lytic cycle. Here it is trying to tell that it enters the host cell and modify the host proteins into viral particles. Why this is wrong? Can someone tell me? Why is this B option wrong? What is making it wrong? Okay, please understand, I am getting many of you are trying to tell that the word enters is the problem, sir. Okay, so many of you are like trying to tell that the word enters is the problem here. I am getting some of these answers. The answers that I am getting is like it is trying to tell that it does not enter into the cell. Okay, please understand, virus will not enter, but virus genetic particle will enter the host cell. Okay, so that is not the problem. It is modifying the host proteins into virus particles is the problem. Okay. Okay, it does not enter the cell, only the genetic matter enter the cell. Okay, that is there. And then like what? Viral particles, viral proteins, it is all the same only. What it is trying to do is, okay, this option means what? Okay, I'm just going to explain what is this option. You tell me whether it is correct or wrong. Okay, so let us say that this is the host. The host is having some proteins. The viral particle is entering. Let it be virus fully entering. They are saying that the virus is entering. And they are saying that this will go and modify this thing into viral particles. Is this what is happening? Is this what is happening? Are you understanding? So what is the meaning of it is, it is not altering anything with the host protein. It is not touching the protein at all. Okay. It is, what is it trying to do? It is trying to go and insert the gene, and it is taking control of the entire process. Okay. According to this point, what it is trying to tell is, it is trying to tell that it is entering the host cell and modify the host proteins into viral particles. So whatever is bacterial, it is trying to convert it into viral. That is what this point is trying to tell. So this is not what is happening. Okay. So please understand that this is not happening. It divides it into two on its own. That is not possible at all. Virus cannot divide on it its own. It divides into two with the help of host enzymes. This is also not happening. It will use the host enzyme, but it is not using it to division. Okay. It is not reproducing by fusion or fission. Okay. It is not reproducing by fission. Are you understanding why the answer is A? Good. So the next one, common bread mold is what is the question. It is a very factual question. It is Rhizopus. If you have studied the textbook, you should be able to understand. Viral protein coat is called as what? Capsid. This is also a factual question, theoretical question. So now tell me, what is this capsid made up of? Capsid is made up of what? What are the individual units in capsid is called as? Capsid itself is protein, man. What is it made up of? I mean, like, that small units are called as what? Very good. I'm getting good answers. Right. Good. Okay. The next one, which of the following is likely to be present in thermal vents? What is the meaning of thermal vent? Thermal vent is a place where you have some area where you are getting like some hot steam or hot water. That kind of area is what we call it as a thermal vent. Okay. Below the earth, you have some regions. There are some gases which are trapped. And these gases are like kind of like, it will try to heat up and then like it will try to come out. Okay, that area will be like kind of from here, like if suppose water bed is there, from here you will get that hot water spring will be there. Okay, those kind of things and all will be there. So that region is what we call it as thermal vent. Okay, so in such area which is possible to live, archaebacteria only can be able to. It will be able to live. 169. The most primitive fungi is phycomycetes. Okay, phycomycetes are the most thing. In phycomycetes, the oomycetes is the oldest class fungi. Oomycetes are the oldest fungi. What is clam connection? Clam connection is found in which one? I want you to read this solution because this has some extra points. So please read this thing. What is it trying to tell? Basidiomycetes is the answer. A clam connection is a structure that is formed by growing hyphal cells of certain fungi. It ensures that each cell or segment of hypha receives a different nuclei, which are obtained through mating of hypha of different sexual types. This is unique in basidiomycetes. Okay. This is a feature used to identification as an identification tool for this phylum. So normally what will happen is, when you're talking about zygomycetes, for zygomycetes, what will happen? This is one hypha. This is another hypha. Okay. And then there is this hypha will have a small protrusion. This hypha will have a small protrusion. And they will fuse together as a common thing. This is what will happen in zygomycetes. In basidiomycetes, you have a hypha. Okay. You have another hypha. In between two, you have a small connection, like a conjugation tube, pili kind of thing. This is called as a clam connection. Okay. So here what will happen? Here, from here also, this will come here. Here also, this will come here, and then it will try to fuse in this region, in zygomycetes. Whereas in case of basidiomycetes, it is like this. So the movement will happen from here to here, and it will happen from here to here. So this in between, that small bridge-like structure, is what we call it as a clamp connection. So this kind of clamp connection is seen only where? It is seen only in basidiomycetes. Okay. So this clamp connection is very unique for this particular thing. It is a small bridge-like structure. Okay, a clamp connection is a structure formed by growing hyphal cells of certain fungi. Okay, the hyphal cells are growing. These two things are growing to form a connection. Okay. It ensures that each cell of segment of hypha receives a different nuclei. So what will happen is, like, let us say, if this is the nucleus which is here, and this is the nucleus which is there. Okay, this will start to move here, and this will start to move here. So here you will have like lots of this thing. Here you will have lots of white. So some white from this side will move to that side. This yellow from this side will move to that side. Okay. So this is how your clamp connection will be there. And this is like kind of a very unique feature for basidiomycetes. That is what they are trying to tell. This is a very unique to basidiomycetes. Okay, so they are not found in ascomycetes. It is very much useful in classification. Clam connections are structures unique to phylum, basidiomycota. Okay, it is seen in basidiocarps. You cannot see the same thing in ascocarps. Okay. Are we able to understand? Can we move on? So the next one, 171, which of the following is used extensively in biochemical work and genetic work? This is taken directly from the NCERT textbook. You need to read the examples which are found here. You please understand that Neurospora is extensively used in biochemical and genetic work. Okay, so it is like kind of directly taken from the NCERT textbook. So Neurospora is ascomycetes. Ascomycetes learned, this is like kind of an example. Okay. Next 172nd question, in archaebacterial cell, which of the following is absent? Please understand that in archaebacteria, peptidoglycan is not there. Instead of peptidoglycan, you have pseudopeptidoglycan. Okay, the wall of archaebacteria is composed of S layers. It will be like kind of lacking peptidoglycan molecules, with an exception of methanobacteria, which will have pseudopeptidoglycan in their cell wall. Okay, methanobacteria alone will have pseudopeptidoglycan. Apart from that, you will have something called as S layers. Okay. Are we able to understand? So what is this S layer? S layer is a crystalline layer. Okay. It is like kind of unique only in which category? Archaea. Next one. 173. Kingdom Plantae contains which of the following body organization? Plantae will have both tissue as well as organ. Okay, in case of algae and all, it will have only tissues. It might not have organs. But gradually, as you move on to other phylums, other categories, you will be able to see that other divisions will have organs. Which of the following is not a protist? Okay, we know that Claviceps is what? Claviceps is a fungus. Okay, Physarum is a slime mold. Radiolaria is a sarcodyne. Triceratium is what? What is Triceratium? Is it a dinoflagellate or? Triceratium fungi, yaar sonna. Claviceps fungi, Physarum slime mold, Radiolaria sarcodyne, Triceratium, what is it? Triceratium is amoeboid. Look at your notes, refer it and tell me properly. It is a diatom. It's a diatom. Please refer your notes. These are all examples that I have given to you already. Okay. The next one. A virus considered living as why can be considered as living because what is the case? Virus can cause disease. We cannot say that it is because causing disease. Okay, you have other things which are not living but still can cause a disease. Like say for example, pollen grain, which is like not having, okay, pollen grain, dust particles. You talk about dust particles entering into your respiratory tract. They can create diseases. So it is not just because they are causing disease, we consider it as living. Virus cannot respire at all. Viruses will not be like requiring oxygen. It is not having any mechanism. So it is not there. Virus cannot respond to touch and all. You cannot touch a virus as such. Viruses reproduce inside the host. That is why we consider it as living in this particular point. But there are these points and all will be like consider making it what? Non-living. Which of the following is not true about the spore in slime molds? Okay. They are extremely resistant to heat and pressure. Yes, the spore is extremely resistant. They are produced only in unfavorable conditions. That is also correct. They have true wall is also correct. They are dispersed and produced during favorable conditions is wrong. They are dispersed and produced during unfavorable conditions. So you see here, you take slime molds. You read this part, you will be able to understand. Okay, so read that thing. During unfavorable condition, the plasmodium differentiates and forms fruiting bodies, bearing spore at their tips. The spores possess true walls. Okay, this point is also taken. They are extremely resistant and survive for many years under adverse conditions. The spores are dispersed by air currents. So when is it producing? Produced? It is produced during unfavorable condition. Okay. Next one. They will form fruiting body, no? That is what they are saying. It forms fruiting bodies bearing spores at their tips. That is what is given here. Okay, next one. Some chemosynthetic autotrophic bacteria oxidizes DASH and use the released energy for their ATP production. What will they oxidize is the question. Okay. Chemosynthetic nale vanti it has to use some chemicals, not like kind of organic substance. The word fatty acid and amino acid here are connected with what? They are connected with what substance? They are organic. You can talk about these two things. Out of these two things, H2S is not something which is used as a source of energy. H2S is used only as what? H2S is used only as an electron donor. You will not understand this thing if I till you understand photosynthesis. Okay, so here there is something that you need to understand. What is that something that you need to understand? You use something. If you talk about photosynthesis, you have carbon dioxide, you have water. What is the role of carbon dioxide? What is the role of water? What is the role of carbon dioxide and what is the role of water? Water is an electron donor. And carbon dioxide is the substance that is going to get reduced. Okay. So, it after reduction, this will be converted into energy. Converted into glucose. And what will happen, this glucose, what is going to happen to this converted into glucose? This glucose will oxidize to give energy. What is the role of water? Water is going to just give electrons for this conversion. Okay. So, it is not the water which is used to provide energy. It is the carbon dioxide which is used to provide the energy in a later part. Okay. So this is how you will understand this mechanism better in photosynthesis. But as of now, you can understand that out of carbon dioxide and water, this is the part which is going to contribute to the energy production. And water is the part which is going to provide energy, going to provide electrons. Okay. So similarly, H2S is not oxidized and it is not given energy. The bacteria will not consume H2S and get energy. Okay. So, what is the role of this H2S? H2S is just an electron donor. It is also given there in the book. You can see this thing. Chemosynthetic autotrophic bacteria are using what? You read this line. You will understand it. Oxidize various inorganic substances such as nitrates, nitrites, and ammonia and use their release energy for their ATP production. Okay, which means how they are using their for the ATP production, what are the substances they will oxidize? They can oxidize nitrates, and ammonia. Okay. Now moving on further, 178. Which of the following was not taken into consideration for five kingdom classification? I think it is quite easy. Cell mobility was not considered. Yes, everything is found in book. So you have to read a book properly. Word by word. What are trichocysts? Trichocysts are organs. Okay. That will help in attacking prey. I think I have told you this thing. This also I am not trying to spend more time. The last one. Which of the following is true for cyanobacteria? Cyanobacteria are all autotrophs and photoautotrophs. This is also, I think it is simple. Okay, they are not pathogenic. Okay, so this is something that you should know. They are not protists. They are not archaebacteria. Okay, so with this thing, like we have completed one paper discussion fully. I will start discussing cells sometime later, not today. Okay, so let us start with some new chapter. Okay, we'll start with new chapter today. We'll start with biomolecules. Okay, take a fresh page and start writing. This week's test is only the cell. The cell full chapter. Next week only you have cell cycle and cell division. This week you have the cell chapter is full. Okay. So let us start this chapter, which is called as biomolecules. Biomolecules means what? You should know what is a molecule. What is a molecule? First of all, let us try to tell. Quickly tell me what is a molecule. Molecules are the building blocks of matter. Okay, they are made up of atoms. They are the smallest units of compound. So this is what is molecule is all about. Okay. What is biomolecules? All biological substances are still made up of some kind of molecules. Okay. That is what we call the study. We are going to study about what are those molecules which are building the organic matter or the living world. That is what we are going to study. Biomolecules are building blocks of living organism. Okay. There are different kinds of biomolecules which are there. We are just going to study about this thing. So if you are going to talk about the atoms that are making our body, it will be carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, and nitrogen. These four atoms are the major constituents. Of organic matter. Okay, so now tell me which of these atoms are present in high concentration, I mean higher levels in human beings. In a man. Some people are saying carbon, some people are saying oxygen. Okay. Some of you are trying to tell that carbon is the most abundant element in human beings. Oxygen is the most abundant element in human beings. Which one is correct? In human beings, it is oxygen. In living organisms, as a whole, it is carbon. Whenever I am trying to talk about living organism, I am talking about all living organisms together in this earth, it is carbon. Okay. But human body level 70% is made up of water. Okay. 70% of the substance is made up of water, so it is oxygen, which is like more in number. You can ask me that there are two hydrogen here for everything, so hydrogen should be more. Okay, no, but even in the remaining 30% of the solid matter, oxygen tends to be the more, mostly. Okay, if you're talking about human beings, if you're talking about humans, oxygen will be the one element that is most abundant. If you're talking about all living organisms, you include all the thing. You have other elements which can play important role. Sodium is there, potassium is there, calcium is there, all those things will be there. I'm talking about abundance. What is the meaning of abundance? Whichever is present in maximum number. Okay, in your body, if you are going to consider, it will be like kind of considered means like it will be like carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, and nitrogen. Tambi, I am trying to tell you clearly here once again, your body is made up of 70% of water. Okay, that is what I am trying to explain here. In human beings, it is not carbon. Please, for heaven's sake, please listen to me. In human beings, if you are going to talk about it, it is only oxygen, which is the by percentage mass, which is maximum obtained keta, and it is only oxygen. And that is the most abundant element in your body, if you are talking about human beings. If it is in case of living organisms, if you are considering all living matter in this earth, it is carbon. Okay, there is a table which is there given in your textbook. So please go through that textbook. In this particular chapter, the first itself, there will be a table. I want you to just go through and see what is the level of molecules which are present. So let us try to see the table if you want. Okay, there is a problem here. I don't know whether I clicked the right button. Okay, as I made a thing. So you see this table. In terms of weight, okay, they have given it in terms of weight. You see here a comparison of elements present in non-living matter and living matter. If you're talking about Earth's crust vis-a-vis your human body, okay, this is like what is that they are comparing? They are comparing the weight. In case of the Earth crust, and then if you see this thing, you are able to see Earth crust has silicon to a maximum extent, whereas here nothing is there. You see here, carbon is almost negligible in case of Earth crust, whereas in case of like your body, human body, you are having 18.5. You see which is the most thing, the maximum thing, this is the oxygen. And you have one more thing. A representative formula, okay, this is a constituent list only that they have given. And you also see here, there is a text which will be saying However, a closer examination reveals that the relative abundance of carbon and hydrogen with respect to the other elements is higher than in any living organism than in the earth crust. Okay, so this is trying to tell that relatively that carbon and hydrogen only is like more. Okay, in any living organism compared to what? It is compared to the earth crust. But in case of human beings, the body, what it is more, it is in terms of weight, oxygen is more. Are we able to understand? So you have like two, three concepts which you have to understand. In human body, here this is with respect to, specifically with respect to human body, it is oxygen. If you're talking about any living organism, what is that they are trying to tell is, they are trying to tell that carbon and hydrogen will be way higher in living organism than compared to earth crust. Out of the three, which is like carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, nitrogen, in human beings, oxygen is relatively more. If you're talking about any living organisms or all the living organisms together, carbon and hydrogen will be relatively more. Are we able to understand? Okay, so now let us try to compare. So what is the thing that you need to understand is, how is that that people started to study about these things? Okay, so basically you take any tissue sample. Okay. And you take that tissue sample and crush in a mortar and pestle. You guys know what is mortar and pestle? You don't know what is mortar and pestle? This is mortar and pestle. Okay, like what is used to make that medicines and all? Okay, kuttiya, the one which they will use to crush things. This is called as mortar and pestle. This is not valakai, this is all like in a very small level. It is all like crushable, and then it is like kind of like very small, which is there in size. Olakai is like very big. Okay, you take this mortar and pestle, you crush the sample, okay, whatever tissue that you want to do it. You dissolve it in some kind of solvent. Okay. And centrifuge it and allow to sediment. Okay, what is the solvent which is commonly used? They will use trichloroacetic acid. What is acetic acid? CH3COOH is the acetic acid. Instead of that, you are going to have chlorine in all the places. This is called as trichloroacetic acid. Okay, acetic acid is what? CH3COOH. In acetic acid, instead of this hydrogen, everything is going to be chlorine. Then we call it as what? Trichloroacetic acid. Any tissue that you want to take, if you want to analyze a sample of plant, you can take a plant tissue. It can be stem, root, leaf, anything. If you want to analyze a animal tissue, you can take. Okay. And then if you are going to see, take this thing, you crush it in a mortar and pestle. You dissolve it in a solvent, which is trichloroacetic acid. You centrifuge it in a machine. And if you are allowing it to sediment, you will be getting two things. You will see something called as a sediment. And you will see something called as the supernatant. Okay. If you are going to analyze the sediment or supernatant, you will be seeing molecules. You take a tissue sample, crush it in mortar and pestle, dissolve it in a solvent, centrifuge it, sediment it, you will get two things. What are the two things that you will get? You will get a sediment and you get a supernatant. Supernatant will be dissolved part. The sediment would not be dissolved. What is the meaning of it? There are some substances which will dissolve in the solvent. There are some substances which will not dissolve in the solvent. Those that are dissolved will be found as supernatant. Those that are not dissolved will be present as sediment. So you take these particular things, and if you are analyzing it, whatever molecules that you are getting will be biomolecules. Okay, so that will be like kind of what you will understand what is making the tissue. Are we able to understand? So this is how you will take a sample, and then later you will go for analyzing the sample. Are we clear? Biomolecule will be there in both the cases. It will be there in supernatant also and sediment also. There are different kinds of molecules. Some molecules will be dissolving. Some molecules will not dissolve. You have to take the supernatant thing, and then you have to see what are those things. And you can take the sediment and you can analyze. Everything which is there in the supernatant and the sediment will contribute what? It will contribute biomolecules. Okay, so what you have to understand is, you just have to understand that you have to take that thing and then you have to analyze it. And then if you are analyzing it, you will get the thing. We are not going to study how we are going to analyze and all. That part and all is for later studies. Now in this chapter, what we are going to do is, if we are going to analyze a tissue, what are those molecules that will come? So we are going to study about what are those molecules which are making the organism. Okay, so this is just an example as to how you can take a sample and you can try to do an analysis. If you do an analysis, what is the result that you will get? That is what we are going to study in this chapter. Are we understanding? So in this chapter, you will be like studying about, first thing that you will study about is, the first part is introduction, followed by you will try to study about micromolecules and macromolecules. You will study about, the next thing is, you will study about metabolites, primary and secondary. The third thing is, you will start studying about amino acids. And you will see how proteins are made from it. You will study about fatty acid glycerol. And you will study how lipids are made from it. You will study about sugars. And you will study about carbohydrates. Then you study about nucleotides. Then you will study about nucleic acids. Then you'll study about enzymes. And then you'll study about living state. And then you will also study about other concepts. Okay, so you'll be studying about all these things here. If all these concepts are done, it will be done. It has lots of chemistry in it. I wouldn't say this is a big chapter. Relatively small, but you will have like lots of chemistry in it. Other large animals will also have, I just took humans as an example. Mostly, most of the aerobic mammals will have more amount of oxygen. Okay, you don't have to like worry about it. Basically, like I just gave you a comparison. You should know what is there in humans because it is given in the textbook. Okay, with this thing, we are completing today's class. Thank you. First slide. Second slide. And third slide. Thank you, children.